Nothing adds drama to a scene like something breaking. Bottles, chairs, hearts, paving stones, promises, and window panes shattering bring a certain flair and believability that's hard to ignore. But actually, breaking a bottle on your head? Impossible to ignore and super dangerous. So how does Bruce Willis walk across broken glass in Die Hard? And shouldn't Cranberry Juice Guy from The Departed be, I don't know, dead? Today, we're taking a look behind the scenes at the wide and wild world of breakable props to see what makes their cookie crumble. Shatter. So what is a breakable prop? It's pretty simple, really. A breakable prop is any piece of set or prop used during a film or theatrical performance to simulate the destruction of an object without presenting real risks to the actors using it. Pretty simple stuff. So when a car leaps through a glass storefront, or some swarthy brawler busts a bottle over a bad guy's head, or John Wick does anything, usually there's a breakable doing the hard work. And it's not just glass. There are breakable tables, bricks, rocks, vases, or vases, and even, I swear to you, breakable Motorola flip phones. Yeah, not sure what you'd need that one for, but I guess Jason Bourne did that disgusting thing with the ballpoint pen that one time, and you can bet your buns that was not a real pen. Anyways, the whole point of breakables is to be visually indistinguishable from the real object. Just like how using Monopoly money could ruin the illusion in a bank heist scene, breakables need to match the color, translucence, texture, and size of the objects they're modeled after. And that's a lot easier said than done. And that's just the basics. The most important part of a good breakaway prop is safety. No matter how real the prop looks on camera, if it can cause any harm at all to the performers using it, it's not a proper breakable, it's just a regular prop. And a dangerous one at that. Everyone has heard about how Leo hurt his hand filming Django Unchained when he accidentally slammed his hand onto a table that had a few real glass shards on it. That shot may have made the final cut, but you can't just go around hurting your actors. Seriously, it's an OSHA violation. Plus, it delays filming, so to be extra super clear, don't try any of this without professional guidance. Ask any actor, director, or member of the crew, and they'll tell you stunt teams are an essential part of a complete cinematic breakfast. Speaking of breakfast, to make an omelet, you have to break a few eggs, but to break a bottle, you have to do a bunch of science and engineering. Man, that was weak. Who wrote this? Ah, speaking of weak, here's how different kinds of breakable props are made, starting with glass. Glass is one of the most commonly used breakable props, probably because it looks dramatic and pretty, and also because real glass breaks a lot. Breakable prop glass is usually made in one of three ways. The first method is sugaring, and involves mixing a combination of highly heated sugar, corn syrup, and, seriously, cream of tartar, and then pouring the concoction very carefully into a prepared mold. The sugar cools in the mold, which might be in the shape of a bottle or just a flat baking tray to get a pane of glass, and the prop can be removed. Also, carefully, something most props people agree on is that if you're going to use breakaway glass, buy more of it than you need. Apparently, these things break like, what's the word I'm looking for here? Glass. The second method is the same as the first, but substitutes resin mixtures in the place of sugar and tends to be the more modern tactic. The third way is a little more wild. It's using actual real glass that has been tempered, which just means that it has been treated to make it more fragile and easy to break. More on tempered glass later. Other objects like chairs, tables, cinder blocks, etc. are often vacuum formed, scanned, and then 3D printed, although some larger objects still use balsa wood, which is super light and easy to break, instead. This still begs the question, how do they break so easily? The answer is that sweet, sweet science. It turns out that in addition to being brittle to begin with, the way the breakables are made means that the props themselves have very, very weak molecular bonds, and that makes all the difference. From there, every pane is taken to make sure the props won't create, pain. A bottle to be broken over the head must be thin enough to shatter but believable to the eye. Okay, enough molecules, back to breaking. Some stunts are harder to pull off than others and require special approaches and techniques to properly leverage the breakable props being used in them. For instance, how does one make a big window of glass, more than just a pane? Either by making a bunch of small pieces set into a balsa wood frame, or by using a sheet of that real tempered glass we talked about earlier. Like, let's say someone needs to fall through the glass roof of a train station. To keep the actors, or let's be honest, stunt doubles, safe, a small pyrotechnic device is used to shatter the actual glass moments before any actual impact on the part of the person. There's still some risk associated with all of these methods though, and actors and doubles who work with tempered glass especially tend to be wearing different forms of protection under their costumes. These might take the form of glasses or eye shields because even the most benign debris is bad news if it gets in your eyes. There are also some distinct caveats to using breakables. One of the biggest is to be wary of temperature. See, one of the side effects of the loose molecule bonds and thin resin layers is that the props themselves end up being both inherently brittle and really sensitive to changes in temperature. Those fake glass bottles for breaking on bad guys? Yeah, don't think about leaving them anywhere hot or they'll break early. Cold? Break early. A little cold and then a little hot too quickly? Crash, boom, gotta buy another one. This gets even worse when you're dealing with cups and bottles because the temperature rule applies to liquids being held in those cups and bottles. Hot tea, boom. A milkshake, no chance. So if you want to pour steaming hot coffee into a mug that's going to be used as a weapon in the same shot, that steam head better be added in post or that prop better be made to order. Oh, and liquids? Don't get me started on liquids. A lot of breakable bottles, mugs, and other things you'd expect to hold liquids are actually designed with little holes in them to help make removing them from molds easier and also to ensure an extra degree of fragility. But that can make actually using the cups as cups a real challenge. Some special effects houses, like New Rule Effects out in Van Nuys, California, are willing to make custom props to order that can handle more extreme variations in temperature and even actually hold liquids, but that comes with its own complications. A single breakable bottle is not cheap. They average around 20 bucks a pop, and as every breakable prop expert will tell you, you're gonna need spares. If nothing else, it makes those multi-hundred-million-dollar budgets for blockbusters make a little bit more sense. Just a bit. If every 2B broken bottle costs 20 bucks, and a full window pane costs way more, and the studio has to get at least, let's say, 5 of each just in case they break early, or by accident, how many full rides to college are spent shooting these iconic 3 minutes of buck-wild gunplay and hard-boiled? Too many. But I don't care, that scene is still worth more than my degree. But what about walking on glass? How does Bruce Willis not end up with no feet when John McClane has to make his way through all those fiendish-looking shards? The answer isn't actually tempered glass or even sugar, it's rubber. When performers need to traverse a glass-strewn hallway, translucent rubber shards in the shape of glass are used. It goes to show that there are a lot of different ways to create a convincingly dangerous but actually safe set piece. And that's true of the wooden, porcelain, and presumably Motorola flip phone breakables too. Although I'm not sure why anyone needs a second way to make a flip phone break. Then again, I don't run a successful prop company and my movie studio is still working on that first Oscar, which we should be getting for our Game of Thrones style adaptation of The Nanny any day now. Anyways, it brings a tear to my eye knowing how much brain power is behind breaking things on famous people. Plus, I'm walking away from this video with a sweet new plan for the next time my boss bugs me. That's right, breakaway windows, baby! Staple your own documents, Todd!